Rigoletto by Giuseppe Verdi. How on earth, you might ask, could a tune like that, beloved by pasta makers the world over, get its composer, the great Giuseppe Verdi, into trouble with the censors? Well, the fact of the matter is that almost everything Verdi did for the first half of his great career got him into trouble with the censors. But then Verdi's career, spanning most of the 19th century, parallels the history of the birth of a nation. When Verdi was born in 1813, Italy was a jumble of states, ruled with varying degrees of repression by overlords as varied as the bombastic Bourbon kings of Naples, the sovereign pontiff, absolute ruler of the Roman Catholic Church and of the Papal States, and the Austrian Habsburgs, who dominated and occupied much of the north of the country. When he died in 1901, revered as a statesman and adored as a composer, Italy was a united country. The Bourbons had been sent packing, the Papal States shrunk to a Roman suburb, and the Austrians sent back to where they belonged, Austria. This immense struggle for unification, called the Risorgimento, was led politically by Cavour and Mazzini. The military genius behind it was Garibaldi, and Verdi supplied the musical scores. In one sense, you could argue that Verdi suffered cruel and censorious oppression. In another sense, you almost feel he went out of his way, at least by the time he wrote Rigoletto, to annoy the censors, and that he used his growing prestige as a way to be a burr under their saddles. From his earliest days, he chose subjects which were, to say the least, likely to offend. Censors, then and now, tend to be rather sensitive people, with their sensitivities all in and around the same areas. Biblical topics and the representation of biblical characters on stage tend to annoy them no end. As the subject of his third opera, written when he was only 28 years old, he chose Nabucco, the biblical Nebuchadnezzar. Further, by graphically depicting the anguish of the Hebrew slaves in their Babylonic captivity, he sent a barely coded message to his countrymen about the need and desire for self-expression in the great chorus Va pensiero. Let the thought of freedom take wing. In writing this chorus, he provided the Italians with what is virtually a second national anthem, and probably that very musical country's best-loved tune. It remains a tune ingrained in the Italian psyche and the true anthem of the people, whatever politicians in Rome may from time to time dictate. The theme of his Giovanna d'Arco, Joan of Arc, similarly tells of a nation's struggle, in this case France, against foreign occupation. Macbeth describes another degree of political tyranny, and again the theme of a nation labouring under the yoke of oppression is superbly handled. And so it went on through his great career, challenging authority, expanding the barriers of acceptability. It proves, if proof were needed, that the idea of the artist as provocateur...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.